You and me, we have reached our first model. Not all land is equal in value in a city, as you are completely aware. Every single house does not cost the same amount of money. Every single vacant lot does not cost the same amount of money. Back to the CBD, the Central Business District, the primary component of what we've been talking about in urban geography so far. Land values generally decrease with distance from the CBD, particularly in our first model. Remember the way this worked with the von Thunen model, the agricultural model? So here's the von Thunen model again. You can see the city is in the middle. Remember, there was intensive agriculture that surrounded the city in the first rings. That was the most expensive to produce and the most expensive in terms of buying it once you were in the city. And then as you increase distance away from the city, you had more extensive agricultural products, which means that they didn't cost as much to produce. They could use more land. And at the same time, they didn't cost as much money when you sold them in the market. This is going to work in a very similar way when we apply it to a city. So now we have a graph. And if you take a look at the graph, you can see that there's vertical and horizontal components of the graph. And down at the bottom, in the middle of the horizontal component, we have the CBD, the Central Business District. Now I just put the number zero above CBD, which means the very center of the city, 0 miles away from the center of the city. And then along the bottom, you can see increasing distance going left and right. Now keep this in mind, of course, this is a 2D graph in a 3D world. So in reality, we would be able to go out in all directions away from the CBD. Now notice on the left-hand side, I just put value of property of land. That means property value. How much does land cost? And you can see the green arrows pointing towards the top, which means this, as you go up higher on this graph, property value is going to increase. The cost of a square meter of land is going to increase. Okay, let's put something on it. Now I just graphed property values. And notice this, that the highest values towards the top of the graph are right in the CBD. And then as we come down to the left or we come down to the right, notice that it's dropping down. Our graph line is dropping down. And as it does that, that indicates that property values are going down. Take a look now. In between these two black lines where I just put that green arrow, that is where property values are going to be at their absolute highest. Now watch. As we increase distance where the purple arrows are at, notice what's happening. The property values are going down as we're increasing distance. As we go out a little bit farther where we have the brown arrows, now notice that the property values have decreased even more. And out where the blue arrows, they have decreased even more. So increasing distance away from the CBD results in decreasing property values, decreasing land values. Skyscrapers were actually a consequence of what I just showed to you, which was land values. Instead of spreading out where land would cost a lot of money, skyscrapers went up where the costs were less. I mean, let's face it, what's cheaper? Dirt or air, right? Go buy some air. Now go buy the property across the street from you, which is going to cost more money. That's right. The land is going to cost more money, so skyscrapers went up. New York City is probably the great example of this. Even though New York City has multiple CBDs in it, nevertheless, you can see that it is a vertically developed city on Manhattan Island. And if you look over here, this is the Hudson River right here. If you look out over here, this is New Jersey. You can see that the property values in New Jersey are clearly less because what's happening? You have a lot of flat land and the center of the action is all in here, which makes the center of the property values all in here. And as you increase distance, the property values go down. So we're at our first model, the Burgess Concentric Zone Model. Doesn't it look like von Thunen? The Concentric Zone Model was created by Ernest Burgess in the 1920s, so about 100 years ago. Okay, so you have to keep that part in mind. And it was based partly on the von Thunen agricultural model and applied to an urban landscape. So it's not about farming. This is all about what happens in a city. And in this case, the city is going to be circular. And it was based on Chicago, Illinois. Okay, first of all, this is a model. Like any model is a generalization of the studied landscape that provides a starting point, a kind of jumping off point for further discussion, further exploration, research, and so on. The models that follow this, so after we finish with the concentric zone model, like the sector model or the multinodal multinuclei models, these are riffs on this original concentric zone model and followed it. So they're riffs on the Burgess model. The concentric zone model assumes several things. Now, first of all, I'm assuming that you understand Southern California at least a little bit because I'm going to base on Los Angeles, not based on Chicago. But it could be applied to LA, it could be applied to Chicago or St. Louis or Dallas or lots of other places. First, it assumes this, a uniformly flat landscape, just like von Thunen assumed. Second, it assumes kind of rationality amongst the inhabitants of the city, just like von Thunen did. Third, it makes assumptions about populations, demographics, and ethnicities that come from 100 years ago that would probably be less acceptable today. I'm just saying. Fourth, it works as a great starting point for U.S. cities, but it's hard to apply this to other parts of the world and to other world cities. But it's good in the United States. Nevertheless, there is validity to the fundamental concepts behind this model. So let's look at it. Rings or zones form concentric circles around each other. Each of these zones has unique characteristics to it. So first, okay, the first zone, zone number one. This is the CBD, the Central Business District. As you can see, I've got pointed out with the red arrows. This is the center of the city, and this is the area with the highest land values, at least on the model. And the area where the tertiary sector is centered. Remember, the tertiary sector is the service sector. Because it's in the center of the landscape, because it is at that center of that landscape, it can draw workers from all directions. And it's assumed that the transportation networks converge on this area, which allows people to get into that central part of the city. Overwhelmingly, according to the model at least, there are very few residences here. Not a lot of people live here. The buildings are the tallest in this part of the city, but at the same time, this is likely to be the oldest part of the city, the original part of the particular landscape that we're looking at. The actual population density is low, though, because of the lack of residences. But it does go up during the day, Monday through Friday, because people commute in to work in this part of the city. There are many high-end businesses, typically, in this part of the city. And then there's lots of things like restaurants that service the population that comes in Monday through Friday, like 9 to 5. So we're looking at Los Angeles here that I've circled. You can see clearly it's very vertically developed in the center where the CBD is at. This is also the original settlement zone when the Mexican immigrants came up and settled the city of Los Angeles in the early 1800s. But you know, that mostly is gone. But you can see that there's this heavy vertical development right in the middle of the city that distinguishes it from the rest of the city. And there are a lot of services down there. All right, how about this? The second zone, zone number two, which you can see pointed out with the red arrows. This is called the zone of transition or the transition zone. And this area is characterized by having a mix of both commercial and residential usage. It immediately surrounds the CBD, so you can see it goes all the way around it. Originally, this was a wealthier part of the city, and people commuted into the neighboring CBD to work. But through time, the secondary sector with manufacturing and industry began to fill in the space, thus the mixed land usage of some residences and factories. The reason is because the factories would have found it expensive to locate right in the middle of the city, but just outside that CBD, the land values were cheaper, and factories need a lot of space. The land value is relatively high, but not for residences. It's for manufacturing and factories. In fact, this is a zone where the population tends to be poor, the pollution is high, and there's a lot of newer, poorer immigrant populations and people of color in general who are the dominant demographic. I'm just speaking the truth here. Older, unrestored houses and apartment complexes are the primary residence form. And the population density is significantly higher than the CBD, but it's decreasing through time. So you could see in LA, the way this would be, the factories are located kind of around that central business district. A lot of these factories are closed or they're transitioning over. And in some cases, through gentrification, they're being filled in with apartments. But originally, this is the way it would have worked. Hey, look at that. The third zone, zone number three, is the original suburban zone. It's likely lower population density than zone number two. In most cases, there's more single family homes. And you can see the way I've got it pointed out with the red arrows. So there's more single family homes, but these are generally small versions of these types of homes. And this is a zone that surrounds the zone of transition and was called the zone of independent workers, which you can see there on the diagram. Oftentimes, this is second generation Americans. Lots of these people work in the factories found in zone number two. Because it's close to both the zone of transition and the CBD, the costs of commuting are not very high. At the same time, this landscape is a mix of newer and older structures, all designed to service the immediately surrounding population. So the structures in this area are not designed to service the entire city the way the CBD and zone number two are. These are designed to service the people who live in that area, as opposed to what's happening in zone number one and two. Those service the entire region. There are also likely to be a high percentage of renters in this zone. For example, the original inhabitants are probably gone. They're either deceased or they moved on, with only a few of these people remaining who are the original inhabitants of zone number three. And they or their children or a property management team continue to own the property, but they rent it out to the local population as income property. Population density here is high generally in comparison to the CBD and or zone number four in a lot of cases. And probably all in all, it's higher than zone number two as well, especially as people move outwards away from zone number two into zone number three, which is what people do typically. And you can see this would be places like Montebello and South LA. You can see lower level structures, but still a lot of high density apartment complexes and a lot of houses compacted together. Zone number four, or the fourth zone, is the outer suburbs, or the zone of better residences, as he called it. This is a solidly middle-class zone that surrounds and is contiguous to the third zone. Overwhelmingly, these are single-family detached homes that are owner-occupied as opposed to renter-occupied. There's probably a lot of civic involvement in this zone, so parks, recreation, sports, gardening, I mean like youth sports, gardens, schools, so on, all designed specifically to service this relatively well-off, relatively rich, usually more white-collar, which means kind of business-oriented, higher-educated kind of population, less factory workers. These inhabitants are close enough to take advantage of public transportation in the CBD or zone number two for work, and so they may very well work in the center of the city. And the density of the population is less than zone three in most cases, mostly because of the size of the houses combined with the public provided amenities like parks and schools and all of that. So you can see that this would have been like the way Lakewood was originally built. You see on the right hand side with all these single family homes. That is on the bottom what a Lakewood house looks like. Lots of spread out space. And then zone number five, the fifth zone, is the commuter zone. The people living here must commute to their jobs in the center of the city if that's where they're going to work, or telecommute, I guess. I guess everybody could be doing that at this point in history. But originally, certainly not in the 1920s. In other words, you needed a car or some kind of vehicle, a van share, ride share, something like that, to get into your job in most cases. The public transportation doesn't extend out to the zone. So the train lines, the metro lines, the bus lines, you'd have to connect over and over and over and over to get to the middle. The residences, if they exist at all, the residences are in a kind of semi-rural environment on the edge of the urban structure. They have large tracts of land. The structures are all low-lying. There's no 10-story buildings here. The people who live here generally think that they have a high quality of life. They enjoy what they would consider the benefits of the city. Remember the way central place theory works, that they can get into whatever services they need, okay, easily because they're still in that zone. But not having what they would consider to be the negative aspects of the city, like high density, traffic, pollution, and frankly, diversity, because there's going to be much less ethnic diversity as you get farther out from the center of the city, and certainly all out of the farthest edge, this commuter zone, very, very little. And they tend to have expendable income, the people who live here, to use on the commute, and they live in the least densely populated part of the city other than the CBD, because, you know, people may not be living in the CBD. And this would be places like Cerritos, at least originally in Los Angeles, where you can see fairly big houses spread out on fairly large lots.